Hello, my friends. Today on Antiqua Arqueologia, we will talk about the five most exciting archaeological discoveries of 2021. Let's go. Number one, the world's oldest cave painting of an animal was discovered on the Indonesian island of Sulawesi. The painting dates back to 45,500 years ago and represents the Sus celebensis, better known as the warty Sulawesi pig. The discovery was made by the local archaeologist Busran Burhan in 2017, but the research results were only published in 2021, in the journal Science Advances, by a team of researchers from Griffith University in Australia. The cave where the discovery took place is called Liang Tedong, and it is located in a remote valley in South Sulawesi. The site is difficult to reach and is only accessible during the dry season, due to continuous flooding during the rainy season. The painting of the pig, made in red ochre on the limestone wall, is almost completely preserved and measures 4.46 feet in length by 1.77 feet in height. The depiction is part of a larger narrative scene, but the other elements are less well preserved due to the exfoliation of the rock wall. To the right of the animal, in fact, there are three other pigs of the same species, intent on fighting or perhaps in a mating ritual. The dating was performed by analyzing a deposit of calcite that covered the painting. For clarity, calcite is a mineral composed of calcium carbonate that was formed, in this case, through the infiltration of water into the limestone walls of the cave over the millennia. The presence of calcite has made it possible for scholars to use the uranium-thorium dating method, which allows us to trace the date by analyzing the relationship between the isotopes of thorium and those of uranium present in the mineral. According to the scientific analyses, the layer of calcite that covers the painting was formed 45,500 years ago, and this date only provides a minimum age for the underlying image. The painting, in fact, could be much older than the mineral formation. As reported by the scholars, it could be the oldest figurative artwork in the world. It is believed that it was most likely created by the species Homo sapiens, that is, modern man. Number two, among the great archaeological discoveries of 2021, the most exciting one concerns the discovery of the largest Egyptian city found so far. The news of the discovery was communicated on April 8, 2021 by Egypt's Ministry of Tourism and Antiquities, and in a few hours it went around the world. The city, located on the west bank of Luxor, is historically known as the Rise of Aten, but was immediately nicknamed by the archaeologists as the Lost Golden City. The foundation of this big settlement dates back to Pharaoh Amenhotep III, ninth ruler of the 18th dynasty, who reigned from 1390 to 1353 BC. The city is known to have been inhabited during the period of co-regency with his son Amenhotep IV, better known as Akhenaten, the pharaoh who introduced the cult of Aten and who left the capital Thebes to move to Amarna. However, the site seems to have been repopulated during the reign of Tutankhamun and his successor Ai. The Egyptian archaeological mission, led by the well-known Egyptologist Zahi Hawass, lasted 7 months, spanning from 2020 into 2021. It was conducted with the aim of finding the mortuary temple of Tutankhamun, but what has been unearthed is something truly exceptional. We are talking about an ancient city in a good state of preservation, with lots of streets lined with houses, with walls up to 3 meters high, and with rooms full of objects related to the daily life of the ancient Egyptians. The archaeological layers have remained intact for thousands of years, and everything looks as if the ancient residents had left the city just a few days before the discovery. According to some sources, the city had three royal palaces belonging to Amenhotep III, as well as a large administrative and industrial center. The large number of archaeological finds, such as rings, scarabs, ceramic vessels, and mud bricks bearing the cartouche seals of Amenhotep III, confirmed the dating of the city. The excavation has identified three distinct districts, or areas. In the southern part, archaeologists have found the remains of a bakery, equipped with an area for the preparation and cooking of food, complete with numerous ovens and a pottery storage area. The second area, still under excavation, is the administrative and residential district. It is surrounded by a zigzag wall, characterized by a single access point that leads to interior corridors and residential areas. The third excavated district is an industrial area, consisting of structures for the production of mud bricks that were used for the construction of the temples. In addition, foundry molds for making amulets and delicate decorative elements have also been found. The researchers believe that this is further evidence of the great activity that was carried out in the city to produce decorations of all kinds for both temples and tombs. This has been defined as the second most important discovery in Egypt, after that of Tutankhamun's tomb. Its importance is linked to the fact that it gives us something very rare for ancient Egypt, a complete picture of the daily life of the Egyptians during one of the most flourishing periods of reign. Moreover, it could also help scholars understand one of the greatest mysteries in Egyptian history. That is, the reasons that led Akhenaten and his wife Nefertiti to leave the capital Thebes to move to Amarna. Number 3. The year 2021 was certainly very prolific for Egyptology, so much so that the next discovery, too, has to do with the Egyptian world. It is the first discovery of an Egyptian mummy of a pregnant woman. But let's proceed step by step. The news was published in April 2021 in the Journal of Archaeological Science and is the result of a study conducted by a Polish archaeology team from the Warsaw Mummy Project. This multidisciplinary project has as its objective the in-depth analysis of the 42 mummies of the National Museum in Warsaw. Through non-invasive investigatory methods, such as computed tomography, better known as CT, and radiography. In 2016, when scanning a mummy believed to be an Egyptian priest named Horjuhuti, or so it was reported by the inscription on his sarcophagus, the researchers were surprised to discover that it was not a man, but a woman. The most surprising thing, however, was the discovery that inside the womb, the mummy had a structure that scientists determined was an intact fetus. Now, imagine the amazement of the whole team who, convinced they were scanning the mummy of a man, find themselves in front of the first documented example in the world of an Egyptian mummy with a fetus still in her womb. Scientific analyses have also made it possible to reconstruct the story of this woman. She lived a little over 2,000 years ago, around the 1st century BC, and she died between the ages of 20 and 30. The development of the fetus suggested it was between the 26th and 30th week of gestation. The causes of death have not yet been determined, but it is known that mortality during pregnancy and childbirth was high at that time. It is therefore assumed that the pregnancy itself may have contributed in some way to the death of the young woman. It seems clear, however, that the woman belonged to a high social rank, as evidenced by the accurate and skilled embalming technique used and the rich set of amulets that protected her. The fact that the mummy was not found in the sarcophagus to which it belonged, but in that of a man, should not surprise us too much, because it is not uncommon for the archaeologists not to find a correspondence between the sarcophagi and the bodies present inside them. This happens because, over the centuries, the tombs have undergone illegal excavations and looting that have caused the dispersion of materials and the alteration of the original contents. This mummy also seems to have been the object of looting by grave robbers intent on stealing some amulets, as was revealed by the evident damage to the bands on her neck. There are still many mysteries surrounding this mummy, so much so that it has been nicknamed the Mysterious Lady. The most relevant mystery surely concerns the reason why the fetus was not removed from the womb during the embalming phase. In this regard, scholars have hypothesized that the fetus may have been considered an integral part of the mother, so it should not have been removed. According to Egyptian beliefs, in fact, an unborn child, and consequently a child still without a name, would not have been considered a distinct individual, since, in ancient Egypt, the name was a decidedly important element of the human being. So the fetus would have a new life after death only if it went to the afterlife as a part of its mother. Another hypothesis, much less ideological but more practical, is that the fetus would have been, in ancient times, very difficult to extract given the hardness and thickness of the maternal uterus in the 7th month of pregnancy. The mummification workers, therefore, would not have been able to extract the fetus without damaging it and the mother's body. Number 4. What began as a young farmer in the English countryside taking a relaxing walk became one of the greatest archaeological discoveries in all of Great Britain. it is the discovery of a rare mosaic depicting one of the most salient scenes from Homer's Iliad, namely the clash between Achilles and Hector. The discovery dates back to 2020, when Jim Irvine accidentally spotted traces of a 1,000-year-old mosaic in his father's farmland in Rutland, a small county in the United Kingdom. The excavations were conducted by the University of Leicester, and in 2021, they brought to light the full mosaic, which forms the floor of what appears to be a banquet hall. This room is one of the remains of a large late Roman villa in Britain, dated between the 3rd and 4th centuries AD. Mosaics featured in many private and public buildings throughout the Roman Empire, and often featured famous figures from history and mythology. In this case, the Rutland mosaic represents the epic battle between Achilles and Hector that took place at the end of the Trojan War. The most surprising and important thing about this work is precisely the scene itself, because, in addition to representing a unicum in the context of England, it is also very rare throughout the rest of Europe, where only very few specimens have been found. The remains of the mosaic measure about 36 by 23 feet and are a perfect example of figurative and chromatic refinement, so much as to suggest that they were made by highly qualified workers. Although today the mosaic is damaged, it is still possible to appreciate the overall view and to read its iconography. In fact, we can clearly identify three panels that show the figurative narrative of the triumph of the Greek hero Achilles over the Trojan prince Hector. In the upper panel, we witness the battle on chariots between the two heroes of the Iliad. In the central panel, Achilles is depicted brutally dragging Hector's body around the city of Troy with his chariot, before the pained gaze of King Priam, the father of the deceased hero. The third panel presents the ransom of Hector's body in exchange for its weight in gold. In the center of the scene is a Trojan servant balancing on his shoulders a huge scale, with Hector's body on one side and a large gold vase on the other. On the right side of the scene, King Priam adds more gold vessels to meet the ransom demand from Achilles, who sits on the left between two men. Anyone who has even a passing familiarity with the Iliad will know that this last scene differs considerably from the original Homeric poem. The body of Hector itself is placed on one of the plates of the scales, as if the gifts of the ransom had to be of equal weight to be considered suitable. All of this, in addition to not being present in the Iliad, does not even correspond to common heroic practice. The gifts of the ransom, in fact, were valued according to the honor and the social value of the deceased, and certainly not with reference to his body weight. For this reason, it is believed that the scene does not derive from the Iliad, but from a Greek theatrical work of the 5th century BC, now lost, by the playwright Aeschylus, entitled The Phrygians. The Rutland mosaic therefore offers a clear vision of how, in the ancient world, both the Homeric poem and the play by Aeschylus traveled for a long time, for about a millennium, crossing an entire continent. Furthermore, on the basis of these elements, scholars argue that the owner of the villa was a wealthy man with a propensity for classical culture, and probably also with a knowledge of the Greek language. However, it would be interesting to know whether the owner, during his banquets, liked to share his love for the classics with his guests, or, more simply, whether the refined and precious decoration was just a way to show off his wealth. Number 5. Nowadays, it is known to all, or at least I hope, that Christopher Columbus was not the first European to set foot in America. Before him, there were the Vikings, who anticipated him by 4 centuries. In fact, the Viking archaeological site of Lansa Meadows was discovered on the island of Newfoundland, in Canada. It is the first and only known Viking colony in North America, a real milestone that constitutes the first evidence of a European settlement in the New World. For a long time, however, there was no certainty regarding the exact dating of this site, which was estimated to be around the year 1000 AD. The turning point came in October 2021, when the results of an international research effort led by the University of Groningen that provided scientific evidence of the presence of Vikings in Newfoundland as early as 1021 AD were published in the journal Nature. The purpose of the research was to date the timber cut by the Vikings within the archaeological site of Lansa Meadows. However, not all the wood samples found at the site were suitable for scientific investigation. Ultimately, 3 pieces of wood were specially selected because they shared some common characteristics that made them perfect for research purposes. First, each of these three pieces came from archaeological contexts that were clearly attributable to the Vikings. Second, each of them showed traces of cuts made by a kind of metal blade that was not thought to be produced by the peoples native to the area at the time. Third, they all had their bark still attached, a very important element that allowed scholars to identify the exact moment when the tree stopped growing. However, there was another feature that stood out, and this was the cornerstone of the research. All three wood samples came from trees that were alive during the massive solar storm that occurred in 993 AD. Why was this cosmic event so important for dating the site? According to the researchers, this event caused a sharp increase in the concentration of radiocarbon within the growth rings of all the trees in the world, detectable through carbon-14 dating. Put simply, the solar storm left a clear and distinct sign within the tree ring that dates exactly to 993 AD. With this sign identified, it was very easy to trace exactly when the timber was cut. The researchers, in fact, used dendrochronology, a dating method based on counting the annual growth rings of trees. Do you remember when you were a child and counted tree rings for fun? Well, even scientists do things like this too. After identifying the sign from the solar storm, they simply counted all the annual growth rings present in each piece of wood up to the bark. In all three samples analyzed, the signal was at a distance of 29 rings from the edge of the bark. This indicates the year 1021 AD. However, though the date of 1021 AD corresponds to the time when the Vikings cut down the trees for their own purposes, it cannot tell us the exact time of their arrival in North America. This is yet to be discovered. If you liked this episode, please like it and leave a comment letting me know what your favorite discovery was. If you haven't yet done so, subscribe to the channel. With a simple gesture, you can support this cultural dissemination project. See you soon at the next discovery.